Any aerosol will work, but not to use what it's designed for. Okay, so the next thing is, we're gonna look at, but they don't. Making something three-dimensional is making something that has texture on it, okay? Texture, and we're gonna use a pencil again, because that's the main journaling tool we're talking about right now, drawing textures. The other thing is, if you're using photographs to do this, and you're using a graphite pencil, make it black and white, so that takes one level of decision-making away from you. You don't have to decide values. You don't have to decide whether it's light or dark. Because you can automatically, you can see it on this image. So that's a good technique if you're going to draw or take the photograph and turn it into black and white. You can do that in your computer. You don't have a computer. Okay, things have different textures in nature. Everybody, when you hire an artist to teach you art, they give you a still life and they put a wrinkled cloth at your suit, don't they? People hate that, right? Because it's hard. Here's a shiny cloth and here's a matte cloth. You can see they have very, very different textures. But all it is light next to dark. Light next to, if you think about it, it's just light next to dark. If you get a little more complicated, it's various shades of light next to various shades of dark. Okay? So if you try to draw this, it's like, holy crap. But you break it down into just this simple light against dark, and then different shades of light against different shades of dark, it's not so intimidating. The other thing you can do is to get different textures of things. Simply, I don't know if you noticed, when you rubbed on this table, you got a texture. You remember, kids, you rub things, you know, and you get different textures, rubbings. You can use all sorts of different things and get different looks. This looks like, sandstone cliff, or, you know, if you need textures, you don't want to go through all the detail. You can simply put something under the piece of paper that mimics that texture. The lady I worked with has a booklet of textures and what they are. You know, that's her reference guide. Well, this is a brick, this is a bear, this is my form. So this is what just a plain old building brick. You could go out here on the building and make a rubbing, and you can see what that texture looks like. Here's her format in her office, you know, one of those plastic formats, it has a different texture. Okay. See, it's learning how to do this simply means getting a body of knowledge and a body of information. This is the bathroom tile. It has a different texture. We used to do this in class, but we didn't do that. You could go through this room, and I bet there's 50 or 60 years. 50 or 60 different textures, and then the paper that you use also has different textures. If you use graphite on watercolor paper, this is fine paper, or this is fine paper, so if you use different kind of papers over different kind of textures, you get different entities. Okay, before we do that, Sue's going to give everybody a texture. And you're going to make a rubbing of it, just for the yucks. Put that under a sheet of paper, and you can turn the lights on. That'll be the choice.
Pass them out.
It might be the
right one.
Wait, she's just passing them out.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, these are little ones.
By put it under a piece of paper and use the same technique you did. No, don't use the stump, use your pencil. And just go back and forth. Remember you did this to the little kids? No. It's interesting, somebody said, well, I can't get the shape of a leaf outline. Why not? There it is. You lay it under a piece of paper, and then you take your eraser, and you go around the edges, and all of a sudden you've got the shape of the leaf. Okay? With all the appropriate texture in it, all the veins, everything shows up.
Did everyone get a leaf?
The reason we do this activity is as soon as I collect antiques and folk art, and one of the most powerful things that we've ever seen for sale, it was a little frame, and it was aspen leaves, framed aspen leaves. And the provenance was, this was a group of women on the Oregon Trail. They had stopped in an oasis in Nebraska or somewhere, and they were dog tired, and everybody took an aspen leaf and they wrote their perceptions on it.
Cottonwood leaf,
and they were yellow, and you know, had this beautiful penmanship on it. And it was a story of what they had done that day, and the cottonwood said where they were, these isolated cottonwood along the groves, along the Platte River. So one of the things you can do with this is you can take, see where the veins are? You can take and write, words that depict the leaf, it's a very, very powerful depiction of what you're doing. Everybody's got a perfectly drawn leaf. Leaf veins are very hard to do. No, it's not. There they are. Everybody's got a different leaf. So there's a million techniques like this. You simply, go back to the third grade and the stuff is useful. There are books that said everything you need to know and learn by the second grade. Yeah, it's pretty much true. So you could use those leaf veins as lines, nicely. You can write a poem on it, you can write observations on it, you can do all sorts of things. I mean, she's already got a nice journal page. She didn't do anything. And yet, put some words there, and you've got a very nice journal page. Okay. You keep your leaf. So every year soon I go out and find beautiful. You guys around here have a lot of black oak. Black oak make beautiful pressed leaves, but it's got this, it's this leathery, I don't know how anything can eat a black oak. It's a beautiful, shiny, pristine leather. So we have a whole collection of weird leaves. Okay. The next technique we're going to talk about is, how do you draw fur? Okay. Well, why would you want to draw fur? Well, animals are furry. Okay. And the technique for drawing fur is to follow the contour of the fur. Okay. The biggest mistake people make is straight lines. Fur is not straight. And you look at the way the leg is shaped, or the organism is shaped, you see the fur goes this way and goes this way, and it's short. And when the fur is short, you don't make long strokes. When the fur is long, you don't depict it with short strokes. When it's curved, you use curved strokes. Okay? And we're gonna just cut a piece of that out. We don't want to do the whole thing. Let's look at the leg. Coyote leg. So I want you to make a quick sketch of the coyote leg. Okay? Don't worry about it. Just a quick sketch. No agony here. It's got a little bit of shading on it, because it's a little bit darker here. left on your eraser, you know, from erasing, and use that to put in the shading or put it in with a pencil. Don't make it too dark, just a hint. Remember when Sue said something about making things, breaking things up into pieces that she can manage? That's what this is doing. It's breaking, drawing up into little pieces that your brain will accept. It says, well, I can't do that. So the fact that this toe, you know, is in front of this toe makes it gives it three dimension. The fact that there's shade over here gives it dimension. Okay, everybody watch it now. Okay, here's, see what's happening here? There's just little short lines, and when the hair is longer, a little bit longer lines, and they go outside of the line so that you get the illusion of hair, bird. Just copy what you see. If you see a drawing you like, copy it. You're not stealing it. You're practicing. Okay? You're practicing it. Now, if you're trying to sell it to somebody, then that's a different matter. But if you see a drawing by Picasso you like, copy it. Because you're learning, you're teaching yourself techniques. Okay? You're simply teaching yourself different techniques for drawing. People don't like fur. It's like, well, it takes forever drawing all those little lines. Mm-hmm. Do them fast. You don't have to do them all. If you're drawing a dragonfly wing, you don't have to put in every vein. We get the idea. Okay? You get the idea. This is not an illustration for a textbook. It's sketch. It's got nice legs. And you can tell if your lines are going in the wrong direction, all of a sudden it doesn't look quite right. Right? Kind of got the lines. Not that anybody did that. What's your racers for? Alright, here's the next step. Okay, a little bit darker, you know, see that's a little bit, you know, this is not a real depiction of the whole thing, it's simply giving a little bit more depth and value. It, all the lines are exactly the same length. Some artistic liberties here. See, there's these little things up here. I don't really see those, but you know, okay. You can exaggerate. This little group here is exaggerated. This little nip here is exaggerated. And when you put those dark next to those light, all of a sudden, it's round. Rough looking, that's good. I mean, it's fine. Alright. And then you want to do the whole coyote, then you do the whole coyote that way. Okay, here's one. Just put it, yup. Four. Damn. What is this? It's a series of curved lines. That's all it is. Light next to dark, light next to dark, light next to dark. Okay? So where do you start? Well,
don't see the contour of the cat. And this is just kind of a jumble up here, so you can just kind of go into a little dark here and give that light area. Not photorealism, just a depiction.
So is that looking at the back of the neck or something?
It's looking down from the, yeah,
right here. So you can see part of an ear.
Yeah, probably. The important thing is not what it is, it's what you see. I mean, it's what you want. Free up your pencil. Some of you are a real, just free it up. Let it go. You go different directions. This goes one direction, this goes one direction.